never heard them pronounced before, the Haantjes Tensor and the Nijenhuis Richardson. Thank you.
It is a pleasure to be here in this meeting, honoring Adolfo. I am really happy to participate in this meeting with to be among so brilliant mathematicians and. Even more, I am really happy because you consider
kind of Adolfo's colleague, Adolfo's friend. So for me, thank you.
I met Adolfo 25 years ago. We
had some very fruitful years working together, but after some time we did diverge, no? And I. Another research topics. So when the organizing committee asked me to come here, no, I answered yes, of course, really a pleasure. But I didn't know on which topic can I come here. No? So my first idea, no, was to a topic like this one. So let me. Yesterday, Ramon Benítez, no, told us that we are here. Other reasons not to share our recent research. So let me explain just a few slides on this.
So let me start with a simple closed curve C, the red one, and with a constant length segment, this segment, with both ends on the curve. And let me choose a point in the constant length segment. The point divides the segment into two parts. Let call P the length of one of the parts and Q the length of the second part. So the total length is P plus Q. If the segment is a move around the curve, no? Always with both endpoints on the curve, then the green point will describe a curve, the blue curve. The surprising result is that the area between both curves is exactly the area of an ellipse. Of an ellipse is P times P times Q, no? The area of an ellipse of a half axis P and Q. This is a result called Haantjes theorem, and it dates back to 1858. And the surprising fact is that this is independent of the shape of the initial curve. A generalization of this result is when the constant length segment is one endpoint on one curve and the other endpoint in the other curve, but the same construction can be done. No? We can move the segment around both curves, and the green point will describe a curve, and the area of the inside the green curve can be also computed in terms of the other two areas. Can you guess where I'm going to? Which is the next slide now. The next slide is, because in this construction, this vector is not a tangent vector of this curve. But one particular case is when this vector is tangent to. So is the case we see yesterday, we have seen yesterday on bicycles, no? One curve is the rear wheel curve and the front wheel curve. But, and the point the point, this point maybe is the point where the person riding the bicycle, no, is, and is the, this is the curve described by the person, no, riding the bicycle. Well, but this was my first idea. But unfortunately, I found an alternative topic, the Haantjes Tensor and Nijenhuis Richardson bracket. Sorry, I apologize, because there will be no more pictures, no more curves, no, but there will be instead some minus one, two, some degrees, like in graded algebra. Sorry. While I was attending a meeting 3 months ago, something caught my attention. In a talk, the speaker needed to introduce the notion of Haantjes tensor. It was completely new for me. Haantjes tensor is a generalization of what is called, maybe you know, the Nijenhuis tensor. Nijenhuis tensor is an endomorphism of the tangent bundle, which satisfies a condition. The condition is that the Nijenhuis torsion vanishes. Nijenhuis torsion is something that appears in different areas of geometry related with integrability and so on. I will remind you later. And the Nijenhuis torsion can be expressed thanks to a Lie bracket defined on vector-valued differential forms. The Lie bracket is called the Frobenius-Nijenhuis bracket. But there is another, a second Lie bracket defined on the same space, on the space of vector-valued differential forms, called the Nijenhuis-Richardson bracket. So my question was if the condition to be a Haantjes tensor can be expressed in terms of this second bracket as the Nijenhuis torsion is expressed thanks to the Frobenius-Nijenhuis bracket. So the first part of my talk is devoted to this, to answer these questions. But to do this, I need to spend some minutes by recalling you, maybe you know all this stuff, the derivations in the Cartan algebra, the definition of the associated brackets, and the decomposition theory of derivations on the Cartan algebra. Then I will go to the definition of the Haantjes tensor, and then the result relating the Haantjes tensor condition and the Nijenhuis Richardson bracket. And later, the second part is just some consequences of this, and the finally try to define derivation, degree one derivations with null square. Okay. Sorry. Let's start with derivations in the Cartan algebra. The Cartan algebra is just the algebra of differential forms on an ordinary manifold with the exterior product. No? So sections of the exterior product of the cotangent bundle, and a derivation is just a map that verifies this formula. No? This is the first minus one to something. No? The first slide. Okay. And it is easy to check that it is determined by its action. The derivation, the derivations are determined by its actions on functions, on zero degree differential forms, and on differential forms of degree one. Even more, it is determined by its action on functions and on exact one forms, because locally any differential form can be expressed as product, sums and products of all these functions and exact one forms. Examples of derivations are the following. If X is a vector field, classical vector field, the insertion operator with respect to X defined by acting on functions, it vanishes, and acting on x at one forms is just the vector field acting on f, and then extending all this as a derivation, which is the first example of derivation of degree minus one. Adolfo and I use the Cartan algebra as an example of a split supermanifold, no, where the odd dimension and the even dimension are the same, the dimension of the ordinary manifold, and derivations are nothing but supervector fields. So this is an odd supervector fields. These are the Mitch yesterday told us that the partial with respect to the odd derivatives are supervector fields, are one kind of supervector. What is this kind of supervector fields? Okay, another example is the classical exterior derivative, the usual exterior derivative, and to build more derivations, one need to use the commutator of derivations, the graded commutator of derivations, and in particular, the commutator of the exterior derivative and the insertion operator with respect to a vector field is the Lie derivative. This is the well-known Cartan formula of the Lie derivative. But even more, when we multiply a differential form, tensor, a vector field, we get a vector-valued differential form, and the insertion operator with respect to this vector-valued, this decomposable vector-valued differential form is just to multiply by the form and the insertion operator. And in general, if the vector-valued differential form is not decomposable, one can define also this, analogously the derivation k. No? And in particular, as an example, if k is the identity map, is a differential one form valued on vector fields, the its action on degree p forms, differential forms, is just p times the differential form. An alternative definition of this operator is the following. Ik acting on df and acting on k vector fields is just the vector value differential form k acting on the vector fields, and then this is again a vector field, and then the vector field acting on the function. And we can also define another kind of derivations just by a commutator, the graded commutator of this derivation ik with the exterior derivative. These are the two kinds of derivations, an algebraic derivation and derivations which commute with the exterior derivative. By definition, L sub k is a derivation which commute with the exterior derivative. In particular, if k is the identity, we obtain again the exterior derivative. The main result is the decomposition theorem of Frohlicher and Nijenhuis that says that any derivation on the Cartan algebra can be uniquely written as a sum of a derivation which commutes with the exterior derivative plus an algebraic derivation, where k and l, no, are of vector value differential forms of degrees k and k plus 1 if the derivation is of degree k. So, thanks to this decomposition theorem, one can define the first of the two Lie brackets, the Frohlicher-Nijenhuis bracket, because the commutator of two derivations which commute with the exterior derivative is again a derivation which commutes with the exterior derivative. So, applying the decomposition theorem, it has no algebraic part, no I sub something part, it's just something like L sub something. No? This something is the Frohlicher-Nijenhuis bracket. And the degree is just the sum of the degrees of the vector-valued differential forms. And in the case of the vector-valued differential forms are just vector fields, we obtain the classical Lie bracket of vector fields. So it's a generalization of the Lie bracket. In the case of the two vector-valued differential forms are endomorphisms of the tangent bundle, then the Frobisher 9 noise bracket of N and L has this expression, and when L is again the same endomorphism, what we obtain here is the classical expression of the 9 noise torsion. This is, these four terms are the classical expression of the 9 noise torsion. So the 9 noise torsion can be expressed thanks to the Frobisher 9 noise bracket. And endomorphisms is called a 9 noise tensor if its 9 noise torsion vanishes. Applications of 9 noise tensors are the following. They are related with the integrability, the distribution of eigenvectors of the endomorphisms associated to a given eigenfunction is integrable in the Frobenius sense. And this is related with the fact that an almost complex structure is a complex structure if and only if J, no, the structure, is a 9 noise tensor. And another application is that two Poisson vi vectors are said to be compatible if the sum, if its sum, no, P plus Q, is again a Poisson vi vector. But if P, as a map between the cotangent and the tangent bundle, is invertible, then P and Q are compatible if and only if the endomorphism on the tangent bundle defined by the P minus 1 composition Q is a 9 noise tensor. So this is another application of 9 noise tensor to compatibility of two Poisson structures. No? I have written here Yvette Kosman Svarbak as one of the people who has worked in this area. And another application is that a 9 noise tensor allows to deform the usual Lie bracket as follows. One can define another operation like this one by this expression, and this new bracket is a Lie bracket. It satisfies the Jacobi identity if and only if N is a 9 noise tensor. And this is equivalent to say that the derivation L sub n, no, has a vanishing square. No? The square of L sub n is equal to zero. So this is what I have to say about the first of the two Lie brackets. But recall, remember that there is another bracket, the 9 noise Richardson bracket, whose definition is analogously, because it's just to take two algebraic derivations and the commutator of the two algebraic derivations, and by the composition theorem is again an algebraic derivation, so it has no part of L sub something, it is just I sub another vector value differential form. So this is the definition, and this gives us the definition of the 9 noise Richardson bracket. The degrees now is as if by minus 2 units, and the sum of the degrees of K and L minus 2, and a way to compute the 9 noise Richardson bracket is to do this operation. So this, the insertion operator acting on the part of differential form of L, and minus a sign and interchanging L and K. So, previous to the definition of the Haantjes tensor, let me show you one example that I think that it was the origin of the definition of Haantjes tensor. The example is the following. Let us consider a finite system of mass points in the Euclidean space, and the planar inertia tensor, E, defined as follows, for each point P, and for each tangent vector at P x, let us define this as the sum of the scalar product of this vector times, no, scalar product, the tangent vector. And then to multiply the result by the vector pk minus p. And then the sum multiplying with the mass of the points. So the result is again a tangent vector, and it is possible to prove, it's a long but straightforward computation, to show that it's in fact a nine noise tensor, the planar inertia tensor. But the inertia tensor, the full inertia tensor, which is the same, no? You can see that this part is the same as the here, no? But another term appears here. The inertia tensor is just minus the planar inertia tensor, and another term, which is a function, the trace of the previous planar inertia tensor, times the identity endomorphism. But this, the inertia tensor field, is no longer a nine noise tensor. So I think that this is the origin of the definition of the Haantjes tensor, because what Haantjes wanted is to obtain which condition verifies endomorphisms of this kind. Endomorphisms constructed more or less like this expression. Well, the definition, what the talk where I heard for first time about Haantjes tensor was this is the inverse problem of the calculus operation applications to control theory. There's nothing to do with graded algebras and so on, but is where now it, one of the applications of the Haantjes tensors, no, appear. And the definition is the following. Is given an endomorphism and denoting the nine noise torsion by T sub L is this expression. Let me show you, recall you, the expression of the nine noise torsion, because if we compare both expressions, we can see that this is just to substitute the Lie algebra bracket by the nine noise torsion. So the Haantjes torsion, the Haantjes torsion is a kind of second order nine noise torsion. No? The first is to compute the nine noise torsion and then to substitute Lie brackets by this tensor. In words of Franco Magri, no, the Haantjes condition, no, allows the operator to possess torsion, but in a control manner. In a control manner. And the question is if the Haantjes torsion can be expressed through some bracket, as it happens with the nine noise torsion. And the answer is yes, is affirmative, and the answer is that the Haantjes torsion can be written as follows. No? It's the nine noise torsion, and then the nine noise Richardson bracket with L, again nine noise Richardson bracket with L, plus nine noise torsion and the nine noise Richardson bracket with L square. And to simplify this notation, let me drop a Nijenhuis, sorry, Nijenhuis. And even to simplify even more, no, let me substitute the nine noise torsion by T sub L. So the Haantjes torsion is just this expression. And it can be expressed also in this way. No? It's the Haantjes torsion is the adjoint with respect to the nine noise Richardson bracket of L twice plus the adjoint of L square acting all on the nine noise torsion. Well, just a proof. What time
it's
is it?
It's 9:32.
Okay, thanks. Proof. Yes, it's a simple, very simple proof. Let me compute this expression. No, this is the nine noise torsion and Richardson and Nijenhuis Richardson bracket with L, again with L, and acting on two vectors. By definition of the Nijenhuis Richardson bracket, this is equal to the insertion operator acting on L and the insertion operator with respect to L acting on the this other and so on. And then but this part evaluated at X and Y is just the this vector value form acting on x and y, and then the endomorphism, and so on. I don't want to bore you with computations, but the fact is that we obtain three terms where L square appear, and another three terms where they have a common factor 2. Sorry? It's something like that, but without connections. And this was the first term in the expression of the Haantjes torsion. The second term can be computed easily, and there appear the same three terms of L squared, but with a minus sign. So two of the three terms disappear, the other is the same, and the result is that we obtain exactly the Haantjes torsion. So it's a way, no? This is just to show how to all this stuff can be computed. Well, Haantjes tensor, as I've said before, with the example of the planar inertia tensor and the inertia tensor, are defined because among the properties we have these three properties. If we have a Haantjes tensor and we add the identity map, we obtain again a Haantjes tensor, the same if we multiply by a function and a kind of pencil, no? Between L and the identity map with F and G, arbitrary functions, is again a Haantjes tensor. And this third result is the result that allows to prove that the inertia tensor is exactly a Haantjes tensor. Mm-hmm. Okay, the proof of these properties can be found in an interesting paper by Bogoyalemsky, where the author used a representation of the polynomial ring on three variables in the space of 1-2 tensors. 1-2 tensors means vector-valued differential forms of degree 2. But with the result relating the Haantjes torsion with the Richardson-Nijenhuis bracket, the three previous lemmas can be obtained in an alternative way. So let me show one of these proofs of how, working with the Nijenhuis Richardson bracket, one can show that if L is a Haantjes tensor, then L plus the identity map is again a Haantjes tensor. The first part of the proof is just to prove that the Nijenhuis torsion of L plus the identity is equal to the Nijenhuis torsion of L. And this is because the derivation associated with L plus the identity is just the derivation associated to L plus the exterior derivative. And then if we compute the commutator, the square, basically, is this term disappears because L sub L commutes with the exterior derivative and D square is equal to zero, and we obtain the derivation associated to the Nijenhuis torsion. Sorry. Another fact is that the Nijenhuis-Richardson bracket of a vector valued 2 form with the identity map is minus the vector valued differential form. And applying this, if we compute now the Haantjes torsion, we obtain easily that the first term in the expression of the Haantjes torsion is just the first term in the Haantjes condition of L minus the, two times these terms and plus the Nijenhuis torsion. This is for the first term, but in the second term, for the second term, the square of the endomorphism, what we obtain is something similar with these two terms with opposite signs. Then it is easy to check that finally the Haantjes torsion of L plus the identity map is equal to the Haantjes torsion of L. So if L is a Haantjes, is a Haantjes tensor, then L plus identity is again a Haantjes tensor. It's another example of how to work in this topic. Well, and finally, one of the facts that verifies the Nijenhuis tensors is that one can obtain a derivation, degree one derivations of a square equal to zero. And the question is, an equivalent statement is to say that the triple defined by the Cartan algebra, the form bracket as this, and the endomorphism is a Lie algebraoid with anchor map, the endomorphism. The question is that there are some kind of square vanishing derivation associated to Haantjes tensor. Well, I have not, this is a work in progress, I have not the final answer, but I have some partial results. And let me say that this is similar to a work of Denise García Beltrán and José Antonio Vallejo from the University of San Luis Potosí and Yuri Voroviev. I don't remember where is Voroviev. Sonora, thank you. Where the authors describe a class of Lie algebras on tangent bundles associated to idempotent endomorphism, but the main fact is that is with non-trivial Nijenhuis torsion. So, with Haantjes tensors, I am trying to obtain again derivations with square zero, but with non-trivial Nijenhuis torsion. What one of the results it is possible to prove is that in this case, when L is a Nijenhuis tensor, we already know that F times L is a Haantjes tensor. In this case, it is possible to obtain a derivation, this derivation, the commutator of F insertion with the identity and L sub L, which is of the vanishing square. And then it is possible to obtain a Lie algebraoid with anchor map FL, where the new Lie bracket is this one. Something similar is possible to this derivation is of vanishing square. No, one can prove that this derivation is of vanishing square if and only if L is Nijenhuis, because if we compute the square of this derivation, it turns out to be equal to this expression. So we see here that this is zero if and only if, by the decomposition theorem, this is zero and this is zero, and this is to say that the Nijenhuis torsion must be zero. And finally, the last thing is that in this case, when L is again a Nijenhuis tensor, L plus F plus times identity, we know that it's Haantjes tensor. And it is possible, again, in this case, to obtain a derivation. It is not written here because it's a little bit more complicated than the previous one. But again, we obtain a Lie algebraoid with some deformed bracket. And so in the case of the inertia tensor, it is possible to define a Lie algebraoid, no? As Haantjes needed in the moment. Well, for future work, let me just to say that the general answer is not still not obtained, but another possibility is to work with the definition, like in the analogously to the notion of the Poisson Nijenhuis structure, it is possible to define the notion of Poisson Haantjes structures and to talk about compatibility with two Poisson bivectors related in relation with the Haantjes tensor. And it is again possible, like for nine noise tensor, to obtain the hierarchies of Haantjes tensor. This is just to say that if we have a Haantjes tensor, then all the powers, no, L2, L4, L3, L4, etc., are again Haantjes tensor, like it happens in the case of nine noise tensors. Well, yes, this is a theorem, and the idea to use the exponential is similar to one of our works, no, on the exponentiation of the integration of supervector fields. Well, this is just this is my talk. Sorry for the minus sign. And finally, what I want to say is that I gave to Adolfo my gift 2 days ago, so I cannot show you which which is the gift was this model, no, of a surface, a torus surface made of slices, 24 slices put together, no, and the slices are, and maybe you know, the Villarceaux circles is the section, not the vertical section of the torus or the horizontal section of the torus, but the section with a bitangent plane, a plane which is tangent to the torus at two different points. So such a sections are two circles called the Villarceaux circles, and they appear also in as fibers in the Hopf vibration, I think, and the pieces which made this model, no, are moon-shaped pieces, no. The Villarceaux circles are two things like this, so the pieces are these two moon-shaped regions. So I gave him some of these models, and if you have some problem, you can search in YouTube. You can search in YouTube this tutorial, and you will find how to mount, and how to. Sorry, thank you. Integrability properties of the nine noise tensors are again valid in the case of Haantjes tensors. And what I think is that they were looking for the integrability of some distributions in the inverse problem of variational problems. No? Inverse. This is more or less what I remember of the talk. Integrability, exactly.
Is at 10.